Alright, so now we go to second chapter. So in the first chapter, I try to give you the context about what is chemistry and how it's related to the global energy picture, then coming down to in terms of solar energy and solar energy storage and so on. And now, what we would like to do is come back to the fundamental level of chemistry to see these reactions by themselves. And so before I go to the details of water splitting, I like to actually give you a little bit background in electrocatalysis. So before I start, I should ask how many of you have heard electrocatalysis, if you can raise your hand. So about half of you. How many of you have taken electrochemistry courses? Okay, a few of you. Okay, so let's find. The idea is that in electrochemistry courses, you probably learn all the theoretical background about electrochemistry. But in our class, because this is more contemporary research, we would actually apply it for really specific uses. So I will give you some introduction to it. For those of you who have learned it, you can see how the knowledge is related to application. For those of you who haven't learned it, I think this level is already sufficient for you to follow the studies. And so, in this part, I should start to say that actually water splitting is an electrochemical reaction. Now, the overall water splitting is written as here. So, hydrogen and oxygen coming out from water. This chemistry, even though it appears as one reaction, in terms of technological application, what actually what happens is that we will take renewable energy, either go through electricity to do water electrolysis or go through a direct solar to hydrogen approach. But the fundamental chemistry of this reaction pretty much is composed of two half reactions. One is the so-called hydrogen evolution reaction, where it's basically you take protons and electrons to make hydrogen, and the other one evolution reaction, which is also often called water oxidation, is basically you take water, you make O2 out of it. Notice that these reactions in terms of the reactants and product, they are really important that here you have electrons and here you actually also produce electrons and you produce protons. If you combine these two reactions, you get this overall reaction. Now these two half reactions, they actually can be separated. Okay, that is to say that these reactions, they happen at different places. Okay, and then you combine, you use a medium to transfer proton and electron. Now you may know or you may have seen in a chemistry demonstration that you can do water splitting just by electrolysis, and you get hydrogen and oxygen from two different compartments. And this is the same idea. In fact, in one compartment is making hydrogen, is doing the hydrogen evolution, which we often call it in electrochemistry cathode. Okay, the other guy we often call it anode. So this is in electrolysis, the cathode is basically reduction, while the anode is basically oxidation. In the literature, you can see people using these terms or these terms. The important part is that these two reactions, of course, they are different. And they can be treated separately. And we actually will use each one chapter each for these two reactions. Okay. Now, electrocatalysis, in fact, just like chemical catalysis, you have to add something like electrons. Now, really often in electrochemical reaction, you also need catalysts because otherwise it's too slow. Okay. So we call electrocatalysis because it involves electrons. Now, water splitting and electrochemical CO2 reduction, which is extension of water splitting, they all require catalysts to be efficient. Okay, and so we need to actually understand some electrocatalysis. Now, for lead, we also need some basic concept of catalysis and electrochemistry. And so we first look at what catalysis is. You already know what catalysis is, right? And so I will just use this really, really simple slide. The first line is the definition of catalysis from Wikipedia. You can take it. It's not a really strict definition, but you get the idea. It's basically to mostly accelerate a reaction without consuming itself. Let's catalyst. Well, the phenomenon is called catalysis. Now, really often when you talk about efficiencies in catalysis, you talk about turnover numbers, and that is basically how long you can run a catalytic cycle before a catalyst is killed. Yeah, because everything has a finite lifetime. Turnover frequency, that means how fast you do. Okay, you can eat by per second, per hour, and so on. So these two numbers give you an idea about efficiency. Okay, now some of you may be familiar with homogeneous catalysis. So and in research lab, you do things often to demonstrate principles. And so really often you get a turnover number of about 20, and you get a turnover frequency about 5 per hour. And this will just give to you like a 5 mole percent catalyst loading, and you do finish the reaction in about about a few hours to half a day, and so on. So that's what you do every day in the bench. Of course, what you need in the industry is really much more demanding, and so really often you need turnover number of millions and turnover frequencies of tens of thousands and so on for a reaction to go fast. In academic world, we look at this because really often you can optimize these things under industrial setting, and let require, of course, a lot of techniques, but the fundamental chemistry really often is first understood and discovered on the academic level with a higher number of catalyst loading without spending a lot of time to figure out the technical details for improvement. And so that's the difference in academic research and industrial research. And so let me give you an idea. So when you talk about things demonstrating its practical applications, you should think about things in terms of millions of turnover number and really fast reaction rate. So let's conventional catalysis. When you do electrocatalysis, of course, this coupled with electron transfer. And the basic basic parameters for catalysis are pretty similar, but because you're doing it under electrochemical conditions, you have to use your own specific parameters, and this is what the basics of this chapter. So what we'll do is that we will describe different names, yeah, of parameters for you. So one thing that I will talk about is current density, potential, and lead relation. How many of you heard about what current density and know about current densities and potentials and overpotential? How many of you? Again, half of you. So that's very good. Now, then we saw some experimental graph to just show you that well, the current or current density now are controlled by different things. First thing is called activation. This is a term in electrochemistry, but in a chemical knowledge, it just means by chemical kinetics, okay? The intrinsic reaction rate. But in electrochemistry, there are also areas where the reaction is completely controlled by diffusion, okay? By how fast the substrate diffuses, okay? In a chemical reaction, in homogeneous solution, if you stir enough, normally this is not so much a problem. But in electrochemistry, because you have to pass through electrodes, the diffusion is a problem. And so you have things that are controlled by chemical kinetic, or controlled by diffusion, or controlled by both. It's important to recognize them, because if you want to understand the intrinsic reaction rate, you cannot work in regions where diffusion plays a role. And we learn to talk about overpotential. It's a very important concept in electrochemistry. And so that is the first graph I show you. This is so-called polarization curve. That's in a electrochemical term. In a more modern term, you call it linear sweep voltammetry. That means you scan linearly. You have heard about cyclic voltammetry, right? Linear sweep voltammetry just means you go one direction, you don't come back. Okay? Cyclic voltammetry is cyclic. Yeah? And in electrochemistry, this is very often used technique. Now, I show you an experimental graph. This black line is what you see when you do linear sweep voltammetry really slowly. Okay? Slowly is just to make sure that the current you see is under steady state condition. Because in chemical reaction as well, when you measure reactions, you have equilibrium and so on. So you want to have a steady state kind of measurement. For certain phenomena, you want to do a transient data, because that give you the instantaneous data that can provide you some insight. But if you really want to see under kind of steady state conditions how much current you get as stable current, you do really slow scan. Now, we take a reaction that is really easy. That is basically the oxidation of iodide to make I2 and get electron out. This is oxidation. You can do slow scan linear sweep voltammetry, which we often call polarization curve. When you go the potential up, you see slowly seeing some currents. Okay? And so let's say oxidation, because it's going through the oxidative potential on the positive. It's in this reaction is in this media using a platinum electrode. Now what you will start to see a current. Now we call current is what you see, but we really often use current density, because if you make a measurement, you have an electrode, you have a surface area. In principle, the current is proportional to your surface area, right? So to compare different systems, you don't want to limit to use the same electrode, right? So you actually divide the surface area. So that's why you use current densities. Okay? Then you go like this. You see the current density goes up, and then it saturated. Now, there are different, you first see that you start to see current somewhere here. That is the potential, about 0.56. Because actually, this reaction only will happen as an equilibrium potential somewhere near here. Only when you go more positive than that, you start to oxidize to be able to make this reaction, right? So that's what you see. So that's good. Now, you separate them into different zones. In the zone where the potential is not enough to oxidize, you basically see no currents, as if you have infinite resistance. Now, once you start to see color, you see this region. And in this part, it's called activation control. What does it mean? It means that the color you see is basically dictated by chemical kinetics. If you go slowly, chemical kinetics. So this is basically how fast this intrinsic rate dictates how much color you can go. Because you see, this product formation is electron, right? And so basically, the rate of formation of electron is basically reflecting the current density. Now, once you go this zoom, it's called mixed control, because not only you have chemical kinetic, but from here, you start to have problem that you don't have enough iodide go to the electrode, because the reaction happens at electrode. First, you do reaction. Now, you consume the reactant. The other guys need to come in. But this is called diffusion. But sometimes it's too slow, right? If it's too slow, this guy has to wait. And so what you see is basically a compromise between the reaction rate and the delivery of reactant. Okay? So let's call a mixed control. Once you go to a really positive potential, where the reaction rate is really fast, the diffusion is really slow. So all you see is how fast the diffusion is, right? That's why you actually see a saturation color, because the diffusion under this really positive potential is a constant. Okay? And so this is why you see a curve like this. This is explained to you. And this is the activation control. This is mix control and mass transport control. If you want to understand how chemical, how fast the reaction is, you can normally only use this part of data. You can also get this kind of data from this zone if you know exactly what the mass transport equation is. And without mass transport problem, you see something like this. You know, this is what you see theoretically, or activation control. But due to the limitation of mass transport, you see something like this. So I use this graph to show you what in reality you see in electrochemistry, in currents, and how to interpret it. That is to say, it's not as simple as a chemical reaction. What you see, you have to analyze to get rid of the mass transport issue in order to analyze chemical kinetics. But you also see that really often in higher, when the potential is higher, the reaction rate is faster. Okay, we see this later, and there's a relationship between activation controlled current density and the potential. Now, these two are basically things for you to actually to understand further. Now, the current density that we use here, with some really simple equation, can be related to the chemical reaction rate, which is V. Basically, it's related to the conversion of electron to moles by the Faraday constant. Now, you can convert the chemical velocity into the conventional term of turnover frequency number, and so that is basically the current density divided by nfm. Okay, and so what this means is that these are the way for you to calculate, to relate the turnover frequency with the current density that you really often connected in your homogeneous catalysis. In other words, the current density you see is really a measurement of your how fast the reaction is. While the potential is kind of a measurement in terms of your energy input. In oxidative reaction, the higher the potential is, that means the higher the driving force you have. And we said there's a relationship between current density and potential, which is basically saying there's a relationship between turnover frequency and the energy input you have. Now, this you can you can read these materials by yourself, but basically what I had to explain to you have been already said. Now, in electrochemistry, we talk about potentials. You understand it very well. It means that's the energy input you put in. Now, the potential in electrochemistry is never absolute. Okay, let you know. Yeah, it's always relative to something. Okay, a scale. Okay, and so likewise, you talk about putting more potentials is more energy input. But how do we compare, you know? So we need to have a reference that we can compare in terms of energy efficiency. And that's what we use over potential for. That is, we set the thermodynamic potential of a reaction as a reference potential. And anything that is more to it is called over potential. Okay? Over means extra. Okay? And so over potential, in that sense, it's a potential difference between where the reaction happens and the thermodynamic potential for reversible reaction. The thermodynamic potential can be measured or can be found in some book database where you see the thermodynamic potential, and the working potential can be seen in any electrochemical graph, depending on the experimental conditions you put in. And so we use over potential to describe the difference. Now, in electrochemistry, one of the major problems that we have is that the sign. Okay, the sign is a crazy thing in electrochemistry. Some people prefer to use positive for something, some people prefer to use positive for something else. So in principle, if you talk about over potential, it's an absolute value, right? So, for reduction or oxidation, it means that the actual potential you put in. But in some literature, especially old one, over potential can be taken as a phase value. That means for reduction, you need more negative potential. So over potential is negative. For oxidation, you need positive potential. Over potential is positive. So what I want to say is, you understand what over potential is. So negative sign, positive sign, you sometimes have to deal with the confusion that is mostly historic because there were different conventions for it. So as we see in certain graph, for reduction, people tend to use negative over potential, but this concept of cost doesn't exist. If it's over, it has to be more energy input you put in. How is over potential related to energy efficiency? Well, it's really simple, yeah? We calculate energy efficiency here. The overall thermodynamic voltage for water splitting is 1.23 at standard state. That means room temperature 1 atmosphere, 1.23 volt. Okay. If you do water splitting in a practical device or anything, the voltage you need is basically the thermodynamic potential plus the over potential in absolute sense for hydrogen evolution, the over potential for the oxygen evolution, plus some resistance loss because you have an electrical chemical circuit. Okay? So you always have resistance. And the solution can give you some resistance loss. Okay? Now, if we neglect this for a moment, we of course need to optimize it, but if we neglect for a moment, we look at only the chemistry part, which is hydrogen evolution, oxygen evolution. If you have a combined over potential of 300 millivolt, your efficiency is about 80%. Not too bad. If you have a combined over potential of 0.6, your efficiency is 67%. Okay, so you can see that this is really, really much related to energy efficiency in terms of over potential. So now we understand that we want to have small over potential to do reaction. And for the moment, we only talk about energy input. We haven't talked about kinetic, how fast things are going. Of course, we want to be fast enough so we generate a lot of hydrogen, right? Now, the problem is without catalyst, both hydrogen evolution and oxygen evolution are really slow in normal electrodes. Normally, you need over potential more than 500 millivolts each. You know, they are not really fast. So that's why you need a catalyst to do it. Okay. Now, we talk about a few things, and we talk about over potential, current density, and how they are related. We talk about we need catalyst and so on. Now we will seek a quantitative description of current potential. I already told you qualitatively, if you put more over potential, in principle, in the system, the current goes higher, right? So that's the general idea. But we need a quantitative. Especially in scientific research, you need to understand it. So what is the quantitative relation in current potential? In fact, this is the so-called Tafel equation and ideal systems. And with that, we will learn know the concept of exchange current density and Tafel slopes based on Tafel equation. Now, these are two common parameters that describe the kinetics or electrochemical reaction. Okay? Means exchange current density and Tafel slope to describe how fast the electrochemical reaction is. Now, the way we describe this equation are using reversible systems, but in fact, similar relationship also work for irreversible reactions. In electrochemistry, it's not like in chemistry. Reversible and irreversible, they have a different meaning. Okay? In chemistry, reversible reaction means what? You can go one part and the other part. Yeah? In electrochemistry, it's more than that. Okay? In electrochemistry, it means you're fast or not fast. Reversible reaction means the forward reaction and backward reaction are both really fast. That at every moment, the reaction is so fast that you always have a nurse equilibrium. Okay? That means it's really fast. Yeah? But in chemistry, you normally don't talk about how fast or slow it is. It's just an equilibrium. And so here, when we talk about reversible reaction and irreversible reaction, we're talking about basically how fast the reactions are. Now, if we look at a reversible reaction, I describe oxidized species plus electron to reduce speed, reversible reaction. The color you see is like here, the black curve, okay? a realistic reaction is like this. Okay. Now, this part we already know, this is due to diffusion, right? Mass transport. It's too fast, mass transport. Well, in this part, it's due to kinetic. Now, you see, the real equation looks like this. At one moment, at the reversible potential, there's no current because the forward reaction and the backward reaction have the same speed. Okay. Now, this current on this activation control region can be derived from here, and this is coming from a basic electrochemistry theory that some of you have learned it. If you haven't learned it, it's not a problem. I just mentioned to you what it really means. It means the current you see at any moment is proportional to your Faraday constant. Let's convert to electrons with moles. It's proportional to your surface area. It's proportional to your intrinsic reaction rate, which we call KO, and it's proportional to this term, which is basically the concentration of your species at the electrode. A term of that is relating to your potential input, the energy input, because the higher energy input, the faster the reaction is. So that's the term. Now, you can notice that for a reversible reaction, you also always put two currents. One is the reduction current, and one is the oxidation current. So, for the reduction current, is this term. For the oxidation current, is this term. And so, because the net current is basically the difference between the two. So you get the overall equation. Now, once the overall potential is more than about 100 millivolt, in either direction, the other reaction can be neglected. Okay? Only in the regions where the overall potential is really small, you see that this overall current is really different from the reduction or the oxidation current. But if you have an overall potential already about 100 millivolt, basically, you see these two curves are nearly identical. That means very often we neglect one term because that is so small, we just neglect it. So, in a significant over potential, basically, even for a really fast reversible reaction, the other part of the reaction is very often neglected. So, this is the term for the reaction. Now, if you have zero current at equilibrium potential, then you have these two equations. Okay. These two reactions, they are equal. So at when I equals zero, that means this term equals zero. That means these two terms are the same, and we just tend to call this guy I zero. This is called exchange current density. Exchange current. If you divide it by the surface area, it's called exchange current density. Okay, so that is this guy. Now, if you take this term into this equation, you can rearrange this guy into this equation. Basically, replace the standard one as IO, then you get the equation like this. Okay. Now, we already said when the over potential is significantly large, you can actually neglect one term. So, at that condition, you get this equation that relate the real current you see to a constant value, which is called exchange current, and the term which actually related to the potential input that is over potential. Okay, so normally you have F over potential over RT. This is your energy input, but in electrochemistry there is a certain specialty in terms of a term that is called a transfer coefficient, which describes how efficient the energy input is converted into chemical kinetic. Okay, very often you use 0.5. That means, you know, it's a symmetric transition state, so you get about 50% of transfer of the energy input into a activation energy. Okay, so if you have this term, you rearrange it, you get this term, the over potential and the current can be described in this term. So this term actually describes the over potential and current relationship. And you can already see intuitively if here is for reduction current, yeah, this is for reduction current. So if you take this as negative, you can see that actually the higher over potential, absolute value, basically the higher current you get. Okay. Now you can see that this form is basically the form of so-called Tuffle equation, which means the over potential is related to the log of current into this equation. Now in this case, the coefficient for the guy B is shown here, is related to RT over transfer current density over F. And in a one electron chemistry, that is basically saying that the Tuffle slope, this is a so-called Tuffle slope, is about 180 millivolt. So that's the Tuffle slope. Well, A is basically this term, which is basically a complicated form term of exchange current sensitivity. So from the value of A, you can actually get the value of exchange current IO. So what I'm showing here really briefly is that from a theoretical point of view, using a reversible reaction, you can derive the current potential relationship as something like a Tuffle equation, okay, which related over potential with your current. And so that is important because we already said the more over potential you put in, the faster your reaction is. And so here we have a quantitative description of how that works. And so I will show you basically what in reality looks like a Tuffle slope. So this is the over potential, say for reduction. Okay. So we already said the negative value is just meant to be for reduction. This is what you see, the current, over potential current relationship. And when the over potential is significant enough, it's basically a linear relationship. I already said when you have over potential enough, you can neglect the back reaction. That's why you can have the Tuffle equation with you have a linear term. And the linear term, if you extrapolate it to the log I curve, you get actually the log I O value. And from there, you can get the exchange current. The slope can be obtained here, okay, and that gives you the slope of Tuffle slope, which is minus alpha f 2.3 RT. I already said if it's one electron transfer event, you get this slope as 118. But in a complicated reaction, not one electron transfer step, but many steps, you basically get different kind of alpha. Actually, they use beta in that sense to describe this term. And that depends on the mechanism. So you have different Tuffle slopes. And that means that you can actually use Tuffle equation to give some insight into the mechanism of the reaction. I should also point out that the analysis is only valid if you have data that is kinetically controlled, right? If you have any mass transport issue or other issues, then you cannot do the analysis because it's not related just to the chemical equation. And so just to sum up this part, to show you that basically in this graph, I show you basically two curves, A and B and C. Oh, there's also one A. The difference is basically they have exactly the same Tuffle slope, about 120, but they have different exchange current density. Okay, that means how fast they are. So if you have 10 to minus 3, then you basically see a really fast reaction. You almost overlap with the axis. If you have 10 to minus 6, you see this curve. If you have 10 to minus 9, you see this curve. So that is to say, when you have a higher exchange current density, then you go much faster with the potential input. Yeah, you see, the current go much higher at this potential. But if you have a slower exchange current density, you need to apply a large over potential in order to get higher current. So you see the influence of exchange current density. Now, in most reactions we talk about, we normally in this region, in the curve like C, even with really fast reaction, we are at this step because our exchange current density is normally in between B and C, even for a good catalyst. This is just a slide to show you that assuming a sink exchange current density, if you have a different Tafel slope, how the curve looks like. So in reality, the smaller the Tafel slope, the steeper it goes when you apply a potential. If you have a big Tafel slope, then from catalytic point of view, it's not really good because you need to apply a lot of potential and it doesn't go up as much. So you can see now that Tafel slope can also be used to describe how efficient a system is. So you need two parameters, right? You need exchange current density and Tafel slopes, and they both give you a sense of how fast they are. But the annoying thing is they are not always linearly related, because you will have a system with really good exchange current density but really bad Tafel slope. And so here is just to show you a system with a 30 millivolt Tafel slope. So it goes up really fast with a potential, but the exchange current density is really small. So initially it's really small overall current. This is a system with 120 millivolt, but the exchange current density is really small. But once you apply enough potential, you learn it over, the exchange current density is really high, but once you apply over potential at one point, the increase of the current is really slow, so one point they cross over. So which one is a better catalyst? It's always depending on the condition you use, okay? And so you have conditions that when you have really a small over potential, you limit it by potential, then this catalyst is better, right? But if you can apply more potential, but you want just high current, then this catalyst is better, right? Because in high potential, you get higher current. So it always depends on the condition. So it's just to give you an idea that in reality, when you talk about catalyst comparison, it's not trivial to say which one is better, which one is worse, due to the complicated relationship between Tafel slope and exchange current density. Okay, so that is to give you a sense. Now, finally, let's just summarize this chapter. That is to say that for a system, catalytic system, we want it to be really fast. We want to have low over potential. How do we judge this catalytic performance? I think here I give you a few terms. You want a really high turnover frequency. So in electrocatalysis, that means really high current, current densities when you average it by surface area. You want really small over potential, yeah, because you want energetically to be efficient. And you also want that you put in some, if you put in some actual energy, the color increase a lot, right? So you want actually a small Tafel slope, right? So that's good. The problem is, of course, a lot of these parameters are connected, so you cannot tune one without influencing the other, right? And so that means you actually need to use 2D or 3D graph instead of just a simple parameter to judge which catalyst is better, right? Depending on the application conditions and depending on what your main purpose is. And finally, which I haven't talked about it in all this kinetic analysis, is that you also want a stable catalyst. That means a lot of turnover number. That means a long lifetime. So fast and efficient are just one parameter, kinetic, but you also want something to last forever. So with that, I will finish this chapter. I basically give you a really quick description of the parameter that one will need to judge in electrocatalysis, mostly in a heterogeneous surface, okay? Which is related to really under technologically relevant conditions. So we talk about current densities, over potentials, how the linear swap voltammetry look like, and the Tafel equations, and so on. And I think these are important concepts and the vocabulary for you to understand, to read papers, to understand what they are talking about. And this is mostly for heterogeneous system. For the homogeneous system, as I said, I will not go through it, but you actually have a change in terms of parameters to describe electrocatalysis, and in the hangout, in the slides, you get this really quick introduction to lead, and lead will help you to understand the literature in homogeneous electrocatalysis. So with that, I will actually conclude this chapter, which is to bring us to the technical level or the words that we normally use to talk about efficiency of heterogeneous electrocatalysis.